Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel United Methodist Church, where our mission is to help people find, experience, and share the love of God. Thank you for coming out this morning in all this wind. My goodness, almost blew away when I came out the door. Today is the fifth Sunday of the month, and the time we honor the Florida United Methodist Children's Home. There are envelopes and some information in your pew, and you may use this envelope to give to that wonderful place that makes unfortunate children find a place to grow, learn, and know the Lord. Don't forget to sign up and plan to attend the Nehemiah Action Gathering for Stream. It will be held on Monday, the 8th of May at 6:30 at Harvest United Methodist Church in Lakewood Ranch. We will meet here at 4:30 for a free pizza and salad dinner, and we have a bus to take us to the church, so you don't have to drive in at night. That's wonderful. Please sign up if you have not already. There is a sheet in the narthex. And if you have any questions, you can ask Pastor Kayleen Lowe, David Brown, and either Sally and Vern in the back there, or myself. Also, don't forget about Lunch Bunch at Beef Brady's. It is May 9th at 11:30. And also, if you are wanting to come and you don't catch up with Kayleen, you can use your nice Connect card and you can put down that you would like to go to lunch. And also, if you are coming to the Nehemiah Action and you're coming for pizza, you can also note that on your Connect card so we know how many pizzas to get. Also coming up on Saturday, May 6th at 10 o'clock, a number of us are going to be going together with Christian Care Alliance of Manatee and some other churches. We are going to go to Sugg Medical, I can't talk this morning, Sugg Middle School on 59th Street. Most of you maybe know it's the new one that's going up. The school is experienced a lot of problems with the student body. They're fighting and doing really bad things. And this alliance is going to meet, like I say, with other churches in the parking lot, and we're going to actually pray, walk around the building and pray. There will be no students or anything like that. But if you have any questions or would like to just kind of help up with that, it won't be anything long, but it would be a wonderful thing to do. They need help. So see me with any questions. We also still need some people for the trip to Broadway Palms. And if you are still on there, if you've not paid, please do that. See Barbara after church. She's back there and will be in the narthex. Don't miss out on that great day. We're really looking forward to it. Two very sad announcements this morning. The first is that we have lost our longtime and loyal winter visitor, Tom Craig. He passed into eternal life on Wednesday, April 19th, and services were held this weekend in Missouri. Please, your love and prayers out to Nita and the family. And also yesterday, we had a terrible shock. Most of you know Dee Scott, our dear friend and member. Her oldest son died on Friday. We don't have a lot of information, but I understand there is supposed to be an obituary in the newspaper tomorrow. So please, please keep Dee in your prayers. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Thank you. Through our prayers and songs, our prayers and our meditation and our hymns, the joining of our lives in fellowship, we worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Enfold us in your love and empower our worship, that your name might be glorified in this place and in our lives. Let us stand to sing our opening hymn, Standing on the Promises. It is number 374. People of God, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Please join me in prayer. O holy and gracious God, on this Sunday that we will likely be experiencing rain and wind and all of the weather, We are grateful for the rain, for we have needed it. And we are grateful that you send it in its season, that you take care of us and are the guardian of our souls, that you are with us always. For we need you. We need you to be with us in the storms of life. We need you to guide us when we're potentially walking away instead of toward you, when we have become like sheep who have gone astray. We need you to help us through those most difficult times of our lives and to be there to share our most joyful. We thank you that you understand this and you are present through the Holy Spirit. As we look out into our community and out across our nation, we know that while there are many amazing and wonderful things that are happening, that there are also many challenges. Challenges with regard to guns, challenges with regard to anger, with regard to honesty and humility, with regard to many of the things that we have valued as a country who is peopled with many Christians. And we ask, Lord, that you help us find our way back to the things that you value, that we would value those above all. And we ask that you would be with all those places around the world who continue to suffer with war, such as Ukraine and Sudan. But we know they are not the only places. The others may be smaller difficulties, but that we don't hear about necessarily. But you know where they are, and you know how to help them resolve it. We pray that you would continue to work in those places, to bring peace, to help people come to understanding, and to allow us all to move forward together in ways that are needed for us to keep our earth healthy, to keep our economies healthy, to keep our faith healthy in our own lives. And of course, we lift up Nita Craig and her family, and Dee Scott and her family, at the news of deaths in their families. We pray that you undergird them both, all of them, that you give them a sense of peace even in the difficulty, that they know that they are not alone as they walk in these days, that you are with them, and that you will be throughout. All of us have had loss in our lives, and we pray that you would give us wisdom about how to walk with those who are currently experiencing it. You have given us your Son, Jesus, as a living reminder of your love for us, and through the Holy Spirit of your presence within us. And we are grateful, Lord, that you have loved us so. And we lift up all of these things in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we come to the time in our worship that we honor our offertory time, let us pray. Caring and compassionate God, we feel like we have been through so much, battered by division, perceived by some as judgmental, or by others as too accommodating. We know our witness to the world has suffered. Bless the gifts we give and help them to be used to sow seeds of kindness, healing, hope, and justice. When we as a church falter, remind us that Christ, our good shepherd, never falters. In Christ we pray. Amen. Our scripture this morning is from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 19 through 25. For it is a credit if being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For it is this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore his sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you are going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of our souls. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us plan now to sing together this wonderful old hymn. Oh, I am so sorry. Okay, we're going to have two singing things as we go here. Thank you. us together sing, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus," and you may stay in your seats.
You pray with me, please. O God, may the meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth be pleasing unto you, our rock and our redeemer. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. A guardian. That's what Jesus was for me through the Holy Spirit the year I left membership in the United Methodist Monastery, St. Bridget of Kildare. I bet you didn't know we had a monastery. We don't have one in the traditional sense of the word. It was a different kind of monastery. Both clergy and laity were part of it, men and women. We were spread across the United States. There was no one place that we lived together. We prayed together at least daily by phone, and we met for a week-long retreat at different monasteries every year. For 8 years, the monastery had been an abiding presence in my life. Then for the one and only time in my life that I can say that I believed I heard God speak inside of me was when he told me to leave the monastery. And while I had some loose understanding of what might be the reason, it still tore me apart to do it. I mean, it meant leaving behind dear friends that I would no longer have the same kind of relationship with. For at least a year thereafter, I tried to pray the liturgy as we had done together, and most times I just ended up in tears. I felt like I had gone astray rather than following Jesus, even though I'd gone nowhere. In fact, my prayers were reduced to help and thanks and not much else. I wandered in a dark night of the soul. At some point, I realized, though, that I was no longer suffering in seeming nothingness, and that the sorrow of leaving was beginning to decrease. It was then that I knew Jesus had been with me the entire time, my shepherd, my guardian, seeing to it that in my sorrow I did not go astray. When I read our text for today, I already knew that I had experienced what it is for Jesus to be the guardian of my soul. As we continue in 1 Peter this week, Peter speaks of the shepherd and guardian of our souls, Jesus. Perhaps more than any other, Psalm 23 speaks to the tender care that a shepherd provides for us, that God provides for us. This may explain Peter's use of metaphors reminiscent of Psalm 23 in our text. Peter has some pretty difficult things to address right there at the beginning of the text, namely endurance and suffering, both of which Jesus did on our behalf. The word endure occurs three times in the opening verses as Peter addresses the idea of when suffering is or isn't a credit to us. Before we go there, though, I need to read the single verse that is actually supposed to open this text. Gayla did not read it, and I did that on purpose. And the reason is that I work with the Revised Common Lectionary, and so they have a list of readings that you do on particular Sundays. And they leave this first verse out, but I think it's to our detriment. You'll understand what I mean about why they might have left it out when you hear it. Verse 18 says, "Slaves, accept the authority of your masters with all deference." Not only those who are kind and gentle, but also those who are harsh. Now, given our country's history with slavery, that verse just doesn't seem okay, does it? And I'm sure that that may be part of why they left it out. It may also be because there's different views on what that means. But the issue with leaving it out from my standpoint is that the text doesn't quite make sense without it. With that verse in mind, we have a different understanding of verse 20, where it says, "If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval." Understand, Peter is not advocating for slavery, but rather he's speaking to the reality of his time, because estimates go somewhere between 30% and 40% of all people at the time that Peter would be writing were enslaved. They were enslaved primarily either because they were prisoners of war of the Romans, or that they had sold themselves into servitude, or sometimes also their families, in order to pay debts that they could not pay. Therefore, Peter had to speak to this reality, for there were Christians who were slaves, who also needed Jesus as the guardian of their souls. Now, Peter goes on to remind us that Christ also suffered in a way that left us an example of how the Christian should endure such suffering. In the text, it says, "When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten. Instead, Christ entrusted himself to the one who judges justly." You may remember from last week's sermon that we talked about God and his impartial judgment. And that that will happen for everyone, and it's a little reference back to that. Christ's example reveals an ability to endure without lashing out at the source of his suffering, because he trusts himself to the one who judges justly. Not because Christ himself needs to be judged, but because he trusted God to judge impartially, even those who caused his suffering. Scott Larson, in his book, A Place for Skeptics, tells the story of Annette and her husband, who were missionaries in Western Europe. When they scheduled her for surgery to remove a tumor the size of a grapefruit from her spine, it was not considered a high-risk surgery. Nevertheless, when she awoke after surgery, she was paralyzed from the waist down. They and their five children returned to the U.S. not long after that, and Larson tells of his first meeting with her. He said, "What I encountered when I entered their home was a beautifully dressed woman whose outward expression revealed little of the pain that she endured." He said, "During my five-hour visit, Annette served as a gracious hostess who shared her story with honesty. She told how when she first came out of surgery that she and all of her friends and family were praying for God to heal her, but that when it became evident that she would need 24-hour-a-day care at home, she began to be depressed. Most people stopped connecting with her. Their lives moved on while Annette's stood still. Bible college and missionary training had not equipped her to deal with the reality was of life tied to a wheelchair filled with constant pain. She said, "I felt that I was left with only three choices: to kill myself and end the unbearable suffering for us all, to abandon my faith in God and merely exist on painkillers, or to put my energies to discovering God in the midst of all this suffering." Annette's face beamed when she said, "I chose number three." "And as I began slowly reading the Bible," she said, "again through the lens of pain and suffering, what I saw was that God was familiar with both. I thought my pain and suffering had taken me to a place where God could never be found." Some of us in here may have been in that place, may be in that place right now. But she said, "It was a place where he became more real to me than I had ever known him to be." She found God through Jesus Christ to be the shepherd and guardian of her soul, even if her body was not functioning the way that she wanted it to be. Related to Jesus' sufferings, we often hear that phrase that tells us that by his wounds we have been healed, which clearly links what he endured on the cross to the forgiveness of our sins, the healing of our souls, if you will, that we find in the text. It's the verse before that, though, that astounds me every time I read it. "He himself," he meaning Jesus, "himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that free from sins we might live in righteousness." I mean, consider that. Jesus, who did not sin, bore the weight of all sin from everywhere at every time from anybody on the cross. We often forget that for him, the worst part of being crucified was not being nailed to a cross or the scourging or the beatings or the jeering of the people or the roughness of the soldiers. It was the sin that he bore in his body on the cross for our sakes. For every person who ever was or ever will be, that we might become righteous. That sin, our sin, made him like us in that moment. And at the same time, opened the door for us to become sinless like him when we come to him. Indeed, he was the shepherd and guardian of our souls and continues to be even now, always ready to forgive the ones who draw near to him in repentance and live their lives in and through him. How often, though, do we instead find ourselves lost and going astray? J. Ellsworth Callas, in his book, The Ten Commandments from the Backside, shared the following reflection. He said, the biggest issue in our lives is priorities. Well, you don't have to be religious to know that. We all acknowledge it every day, dozens of times a day. It is the essence of life for we list makers. We draw up the list of things we plan to do, and we put them in order that they need to be done, and we have set our priorities. For those whose budget is stretched to the limits, they stack up their bills, and they put the ones on top where the creditor will be the most heartless. For some, though, it doesn't get any more existential than a box of chocolates. Do I eat the creams first or do I eat the caramels first? Most of us manage our priorities reasonably well, he said. Interestingly enough, we also do pretty well at the frightening extremities of life. Think about if our house catches fire, for instance, we'll probably quickly and incisively make decisions about what we take with us and what we don't. But life itself is a more complicated call. Renowned preacher and author George Buttrick came one day, he said, upon a farmer who had just retrieved a lost lamb, or lost sheep. And when Buttrick asked how sheep wander away, the farmer just said, you know what? They just nibble themselves lost. They have their heads down. They go to the one tuft of grass. They see the next tuft of grass. They go on to the next tuft of grass. And pretty soon, they're completely lost. And he went on to, and that, of course, is what happens with life. It happens to us. But here's what he says about it. He says, unless we purposely establish a structure of priorities, we will nibble away at each inconsequential tuft of decision until life is gone and we have little idea what has happened to it. Peter certainly thought the people of his day were going astray. As he linked the forgiveness Jesus provides by bearing our sins on the cross with where we had been headed, when he says, you were going astray like sheep. And if like sheep, it is so easy to go astray, it is no wonder that we need a shepherd to keep us from getting lost and a guardian for our souls to protect us from the slings and arrows of the enemy. Does that mean we will not suffer? No, unfortunately, it does not. We may suffer for doing right. But if our sufferings will not be in vain, though, as it says in our text, if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. We will all experience rain, like we experience the sun. The key is what we do with that suffering in light of Jesus, the shepherd and guardian of our souls. Guido Cowas shared this story in Global Revival News in December of 2001 about a young woman named Hawa Ahmed who was a Muslim student in North Africa. She read a Christian tract in her dormitory, and she decided that she would give her life to Christ and become a Christian. Her father was an emir, an Islamic ruler, and so she expected to lose her inheritance because of her conversion. She was completely unprepared for what happened. When she told her family she had become a Christian and changed her name to Faith, her father exploded in rage. Her father and brothers stripped her naked and bound her to a chair fixed to a metal plate that they were going to use to electrocute her. Faith asked them to at least lay the Bible on her lap. And her father responded, "If you want to die together with your false religion, so be it." One of her brothers added, "That will show that your religion is powerless." Although they had bound her, she was able to touch a corner of the Bible, and she felt a strange peace as though someone were standing beside her. Her father and brothers pushed the plug into the socket, and nothing happened. They tried four times with various cables, but it was as though the electricity refused to flow. Finally, her father, angry and frustrated, hit her and screamed, "You are no longer my daughter," and threw her out into the street naked. She ran through the streets, humiliated and in pain. People looked at her, curious rather than shocked. Shaking and tearful, she ran to a friend who let her in and clothed her and kept her safe, giving her shelter. The next day, her friend asked neighbors what they thought when they had seen Faith running through the streets naked. And they said, "What are you talking about?" They said, "The girl had a wonderful white dress on. We asked ourselves why someone so beautifully dressed was going to run through the streets." God had hidden her nakedness from their eyes, clothing her in a beautiful white dress. Today, Faith is a full-time evangelist with Every Home for Christ, whose stated mission is to serve the church by equipping and mobilizing believers to participate in sharing the truth and love of Jesus with every person and home on earth. Faith certainly experienced suffering for becoming a Christian, for doing what was right. And at the same time, she received the grace of Jesus as her shepherd and guardian of her soul in her powerful story. What about us? Do we give Jesus room to be our shepherd, to be our guardian? Or do we want to do it our way? Believing that we need neither a shepherd nor a guardian, that we can muddle through somehow. What then do we do with the slings and arrows of the enemy when they come? On whom do we lean then? With whom will we find refuge? Jesus can rightfully be our shepherd and guardian of our souls, for he has endured all the suffering that he experienced without striking back or harming those who harmed him. Are we really equipped to do that for ourselves? Y'all may be better off than I am, but I don't think I am equipped for that. I think it's an illusion that I would be equipped for that. Jesus is ready and waiting to help us all endure whatever has occurred in our lives. He's ready to be our shepherd, the one who feeds and cares for us and protects us. He's ready to be our guardian, the one who repels the attacks of the enemy. And we can then stand firm in our faith, enduring in the way that he showed us by his example. This week, my friends, spend time considering what is most difficult to endure in your lives today. We all likely have something. Ask Jesus, the shepherd and guardian of your soul, to show you how you can endure. Ask him to walk with you while you endure. Ask him to help you let go and let him be the one who leads. Amen. Will you pray with me? Oh God, we confess that most of our lives are a mystery. We don't know why good things happen or bad things happen. We are uncertain as to what works in our favor and what doesn't. We do suffer for doing good. Sometimes we suffer because we put ourselves there. And yet you sent Jesus to be our shepherd, to be a guardian of our souls, to help us stay firmly attached to him, that we would continue to follow faithfully even when it's hard, and that we would accept the help that he comes and offers us. Help us, Lord, particularly those of us who are right now in the middle of the struggle, who right now are not certain what the future holds and aren't certain that we have the strength to handle it. We ask for your strength, Lord. We ask for your presence. We ask to know without doubt that you love us, and to help us open our hearts that we might take hold of relationship in an even deeper way with you. All this we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now, if you will rise as you are able, we are going to sing our closing hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand, number 474. Receive the benediction. Wherever you go, God is sending you. Wherever you are, God put you there. God has a purpose in you being exactly where you are. Jesus Christ, who indwells us through the Holy Spirit, wants to do something in and through you. Believe this and go in his grace, in his love, and in his power. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people agreed and said, Amen. Amen.